they, each of them gets 15 minutes for the presentation. So now I call upon Dr. Srinivasan N. Acharya to kindly present his paper.
ओष्टा पिदाना नकुली दंतै परिवृता पविहि सर्वस्यै वाच ईशाना चारुमामिह वादयेत्। लक्ष्मी नारायणौ वंदे ब्रह्मवायु तथैव च गायत्रीं भारतीं वंदे विष्णवं तत्ववादिनः। जगदधिदैवं जगन्मातरं जगद्गुरुं मम गुरुवरं प्राणद विद्यान्नदायिनं प्राणादपि प्रेष्टतमं श्री विश्वेशतीर्थ श्रीमच्चरणं च मातरौ पितरौ भगिनीं समभिवन्दे। आदौ हियर नौ ऐ एम गोइंग टू स्पीक ऑन द्वैत कॉन्सेप्ट विच इज पेक्युलियरिटी विशेष सविशेषाभेद द प्रिंसिपल ऑफ इनसेपरेबिलिटी। सो एक्चुअली द एंटायर कॉन्फरेंस इज ऑन स्पिरिचुअलिटी स्पिरिचुअल स्टडीज। सो हाउ डज दिस कॉन्सेप्ट answers for particular problems when it comes in spiritual studies, like spirituality is adhyatma vidya. So while we learn or understand about the concepts like param brahman and all, how does this concept helps us understanding many concepts? So many of other philosophers, they have themselves derived some conclusion through their perspective. So I'm just plainly presenting the dvaita concept, how Madhvacharya has presented his own ideas on this particular subject. So, and today morning, Swamiji said that Madhvacharya says the wave is altogether different from the ocean. So, actually, what Madhvacharya says is that there are many entities in the world which are totally inseparable. We cannot separate them, but they are distinctly dealt with. In Vyavahara, we say this is Guna and this is Guni. This is wave and this is ocean. But we cannot separate them. We cannot separate the Guna and Guni. So, what is the role and how does this query has to be answered? So, I am just presenting, I will read in between as well as I will present my own ideas and I won't exceed my time limit. So I come from Dvaita Philosophy Resource Center, which is part of Manipal University. And so an entity made of earthly clay called pot is formed with different colors. The colors vary when they are heated or painted. However, the natural color of the pot may be hidden, but is never vanquished by any process. Is this color a property of substance or substance? The pot is inseparable or seems to be inherent but distinct is the question. If we reply that they are inseparable in the sense identical, one abheda, then we have to face some consequences. So there are some questions that we have to address. How a color is conceived to be a property of a pot and not pot in the case of abheda? Because we say a pot is white. It is known that the color, a property, resides in the pot, a substance, as a different entity, and the color is not the pot. So this is how the vyavahara is. When the color is revamped, how the pot remains standstill? The pot became black, but it remains unchanged even if the color varies. Why does not the word pot denote the color of the pot? Black is the color of the pot. Why the word color of the pot does not denote the pot? The pot is black in color. How they are dealt with together when they are one? So when they are identical, how they are dealt with together? The black pot. This does not mean that the pot and the color black are synonyms. Why the words pot and color of the pot are not conceived synonymous? This is the pot and that is the color of the pot. When a pot is cognized, and why not the color of the pot is cognized similarly? So we ask, what is the color of the pot? We know the pot, but we ask, what is the color of the pot? So hence it is clear that these inseparable entities are found distinct. So like that, we know guna, guni and karma, that is substance and its activity as well as its property. And also, it is not possible, if we claim that they are inseparable, it's not possible for us to answer this question. So if they are inseparable, again, another type of questions arise. The inseparability of both of the pot and not it and its color are inseparable or not. The inseparability of both is inseparable or not is a question. So if not, then how can one say inseparability of, there is possessive case, Shashti Vibhakti, which clearly says there is a distinction. So moreover, the word pot may mean the inseparable color in this case. That means Gatapade Gatapadena Neelabheda Pratyayaha. Inseparability of both is together, so it means it makes that Gatapadena Neelabheda Pratyayaha. This cannot be said that the inseparability of both of the pot and its color is distinct. If the inseparability is distinct, then there is no worth of claiming that it is inseparable. So now the question remains, are they inseparable as they are perceived? So they are not distinct too as they are dealt with so by us often. We had illustrated how they are dealt with distinctly. If they are distinct in nature, we question whether the distinction of both of the pot and its color are distinct or not. So the same question in the sense of, while we said inseparability of, so we are asking then it is distinct, then these questions have to be addressed. So if we say the distinction is distinct, then it leads to anavastha. They are distinct in nature, but the distinction of both of the pot and its color are inseparable. They are distinct, but they are inseparable. Again, infinite regress attacks. Also, what could the distinct inseparability do for our previous queries? As the inseparability is regarded as distinct, then it results in distinction and not in identicalness, oneness. So why should we agree such inseparability with distinction? If the inseparability of those inseparables is one, then again ad infinitum is fired upon. So, and also while we say inseparability of both of them, in here we use and conjunction. So that and clearly says that they are distinct. So they cannot be considered either relatively distinct and inseparable or inseparable and distinct. Those problems which were addressed previously will demand the solutions. So the general queries which are illustrated here cannot be claimed illusory because we don't have any superior proof. Badaka Jnana, we don't have any superior proof to claim they are illusory. So what is Dvaita's response to this? So Beda Bhavepi, Yatra Beda Bhavaha Vartate, Yatra Bedo Nasti, Beda Vyavahara Nirvahakaha Anantaha Eva Visheshaha. Whereas there is no separatedness, the distinction is dealt with the respect of Vishesha, peculiarity. So in this mobile, the color is inseparable with the mobile. There is something called natural color. However, the color may change there are different processes took place. But the color is not inseparable. So the color, the guna and guni are identical, but why we deal with them as distinct is the peculiarity, the vishesha of this padartha. It itself, I myself say, aham mudosmi. The word mudatha, the guna, is not separated from me. It's not an individual entity as such. But the people, with the help of this peculiarity, the vishesha, they can speak those inseparable identity distinctly, those inseparable entities distinctly. And te visheshaha sarva padartha nishtaha, the visheshas reside in all the entities. Swanirvahakascha. And also, when you speak about Beda, so the Beda is clearly said in Abhinna Padartha, Beda is said by Vishesha. When it comes about Vishesha, so again infinite regress attacks. So how you say that Vishesha deals with all these? Whether another Vishesha is needed for that particular Vishesha? No. Swanirvahakascha. It itself deals with these aspects. Te dvividaha, nityaha anityascha. Nityaha Ishwaradi Nitya Dravyagataha Gata Dyanitya Anitya Dravyagataha Anityaha. The definition of Vishesha, I'll not deal with this thing. To answer these queries, the concept of the peculiar inseparability or peculiarity, Savishesha Beda, is advocated by Dvaita philosophy. Madhvacharya says in Brahma Sutra Anuvyakhyana, Beda Hinetu Apariyaya Shabdantara Niyamakaha Vishesho Namakatitaha So Saha Asti Vastushu Asheshataha. Whereas there is no distinction, the one that avoids antonymy is the peculiar inseparability which resides in all the entities. Those who claim inseparability or distinction between the pot and the color cannot respond to the queries unless they agree with the concept peculiar inseparability. It is not possible to separate the substances and their properties. They are twined inseparably. It is vishesha, peculiarity, the nature of the same entity makes the twined entities to be perceived or dealt with distinction. Because of this peculiarity of an entity, we are clearly understanding many inseparably twined objects. Yetadrishe visheshesmin ko dvesho vadinam bhavet. In accepting such a principle, what would frustrate a foe? So, and also this concept is also helps us to understand many other things. Formation of the formation. We know how a pot is formed. Is the formation of the pot eternal or otherwise? The formation process. Pots are formed at times by the potter and not always. So the formation is occasional. The formation cannot be resolved also to as temporal. If so, when the formation of the formation took place, then again, how the formation came to place? If it is not eternal, if it is temporal, how the formation again came into place? So the peculiarity again answers this question, that it says the formation of the pot took place simultaneously when the formation of the process started. So this is Vishesha, the Vastu Vishesha, which makes all these to be understood by us. So the Vastu Vishesha clearly says that while I am taking birth, my Janma process also took similarly. So Madhvacharya says, Yata janehe janihi nanya tasyaha vastuhu jani vastur janihi janihi. As the creation of the creation process occurs simultaneously, so happens the formation of the formation of universal categories. So how many visheshas are there? Peculiarity is an innate form of any entity. There are many in respect to their substrata. The peculiarity of the Supreme Being is infinite, as the Param Brahman is of infinite form, actions and attributions. But actually in Anuvyaya Sudha, Nyaya Sudha, it is said that this Vishesha only resides in Dravya. But in the Anuvyakhya, Sudha is a commentary of Anuvyakhyana. But in Anuvyakhyana it is said, Sosti Vastushu Asheshataha. So what is the contradiction? How does the contradiction comes here? So actually the peculiarity does not only feature in substances, dravyas. It is also found in abhava, negation. Those entities of absolute negation, atyanta abhava, have negative and positive characteristics. That is, abhava pratyogitva, that is negative characteristic. Prameyatva, it is an atyanta abhava is also a prameya, so that is positive characteristics. So here also, that how can we distinguish that an object, an atyanta bhava, shashavishana, how can we distinguish it? So Vishesha helps us also in this regard. Bhava bhava swarupastu Vishesha eva vastunaha abhinna eva sangrahyaha vyavahara prasiddhaye. I don't have that much time, so now I'll come to main theme. So taime padarthaha ghatakapalau karyakaranau hastashariirau avayava avayavinau rupadravye gunagunino patanapale kriyakriyavantau gotva gotvo gavo jati vyakti paramanu gataha swaparamanu vyavartakascha visheshaha paramanavascha vishesha nityadravye. So to understand such concepts like karyakarana, avayava avayavi, gunaguni, kriyakriyavan, jati vyakti and also Dvaita philosophy does not advocate the same jati as advocated by Nyaya philosophy. It says pratisvika dharma, prativyaktigataha jatihi, prativyaktigata jatihi. There is no, it is sadrisha, similar, but not it is some ekam, nityam, ekam, anekanugatam, samanyam. They don't advocate like similarly to Advaita Shastra. And so the doctrine of peculiarity helps us to reveal the traits of all spiritual entities are inseparable from their selves. Now let us go quickly through explaining Brahman and his identical actions. They are identical, but his actions occasionally happen. When the Brahma and his actions are identical, why doesn't he create a srishti now? Also, Jiva Kartrutva Vada, soul and his agency, here also Vishesha applies. Abhede Visheshosti, Vyavaharast to Bhavet. Brahman is eternal, but Vedas say Brahma Asrakshit, Srijati, Srakshati, and also similarly, Vyajnasit, he thought, he is thinking, he will think. So, if the God is one and his actions are identical, then why do actions happen once in a while? So, that is the question. Madhvacharya has defined Kriya. Kriya is a power to produce effects. This resides in the Supreme Being always, but it does not manifest always. So, when it is manifested, it produces different effects. Then we deal with it. Manifestation is a particular state of power. That is why actions take occasionally, though they are identical with the Brahma. Ishvara Kriya is of twofold, potential and manifest. Madhvacharya explains that Vishesha, the peculiarity, by its very nature, accounts for the judgments of difference and such other facts with reference to other identical things, is that which does not intermix those irregular actions and avoid any such contingencies. Hence, Srishti happens at once, Nasha at other time. Jivaha, Jiva Kartrutvavada, here also Vishesha helps us to understand the concept. Jivaha Trinam Uttapayati. If the Jiva is one indivisible whole, then how does he lift a small grass? Only if he had a part, Amsha, then he uses a part to perform a particular action.
So, you have only, Mr. Acharya, you have only 2 minutes left.
Okay,
please.
Fine. So, I am almost done.
Yes.
So, and also it is, some philosophical school says that Upadhi, an external actor, factor, helps Jiva to do such action. But what Madhvacharya does, he quotes a Shruti, Puranic statement, Anamshasyapi Jivasya, Kinchit Samartya Yojanam, Karyeshu Yak Karotyadha, Namastasmai Swayambhuve. Obeisance to that Swayambhu, who makes the Jiva, though he is partless, use only a little energy. Brahma makes the Jiva to use his little energy in the action. The partless Jiva's actions are understood with the help of peculiarity, that his Amsha, though it is identical with him, it helps the Jiva to perform the action. So this is Madhvacharya's statement that I conclude with this statement. Gunakriya jatipurvaha dharmaha sarvepi vastunaha rupameva dvidam tacha yavadvastu chakanditam kandite bedaha aikyancha yavadvastu na bhedavat kanditam rupamevatra vikaropi vikarinaha karyakaranayoshchaiva tataiva gunatadvatoho विशिष्ट क्रिया क्रियावतोश्चैव तथा जाति विशेषयोः विशिष्ट शुद्धयोश्चैव तथैव अंशांशिनोरपि. And also Madhvacharya says that the Vishesha, the perception, is the main criterion to justify the thing, and the one who perceives the traits distinctly from the soul will fail in understanding the truth. This is Madhvacharya's statement. And describing the traits of the sentient beings, Vedic hymns have contested separateness, so the peculiarity of the entity deals with him in respect of conceiving them distinctly. So Anandam Brahmano Vijnanam Anandam Brahma. And also he says that as the parts of a human form of sugar cube is inseparable from sweetness, though called parts of that cube, similarly Brahman and his attributes, Jivatman and his attributes, are inseparable but dealt with distinctly. And however, I have not dealt with the entire Vishesha aspect, so I refer to many articles and many books. I thank those authors, as well as I thank Professor Varkedi, who went through this paper and supported me a lot, and the entire CIF and CIFSS team, as well as my Manipal University team, those who supported me and also I am really proud and I feel privileged to stand in front of Professor V.N. Jha and other August gathering to address a very small concept, though I am a child. So still, whatever I may have made mistakes here, I honestly apologize and also I thank you for hearing so patiently.
Very good. Listen to me. Thank you, very good. Now I call upon Dr. Yamuna. Madam, please.
Respected Chair, Mr. Sir, Dr. V.N. Jha, sir, scholars. Title of my paper is Purushartha in Bhartrahari's Vyakarana Darshana. Generally, Indian traditional educational systems have spirituality as their base. Sanskrit Vyakarana is not an exception. Bhartrahari gave Vyakarana the status of a darshana. He put forward the concept of Purushartha as the underlying principle of this darshana. This paper discusses the concept of Purushartha put forward by Bhartrahari in his Vakyapadiya. I am skipping the introductory portion. Second subtitle is Concept of Purushartha in Indian Philosophy. The main points in this section is the dharma, what is the meaning, concept of dharma, artha, kama and moksha in Indian philosophy generally. Dharma in Mimamsa means yajnadi karma, chodana lakshano dharma ityadi sutraihi. In dharma sutras, it is virtues like as in Manusmriti, kshama dhriti kshama damosteyam shaujam indriya nigraha dhir vidya satyam akrodho dashagam dharma lakshanam, patience, forgiveness, self control, honesty, sanctity, control of senses, reasoning, knowledge or learning, truthfulness and absence of anger are the essence of dharma. This word is derived from the root dhrinya dharana poshnayoho. Dharana, it is said in Mahabharata, dharana dharma mityahur dharmena vidhrida prajaha sa syat dharana samyukta, yes syat dharana samyukta sa dharma iti nischayaha. This means dharma is the one that upholds the universe and mankind is supported by this dharma. In Mahabharata, ahimsa satyam akrodhas tapodhanam damomatihi anasuyapyamatsaryam anishya shilam evacha ityadi. This shows dharma as virtue, and duties like varnashrama dharmas are also called by in dharma shastra as dharma. In nyaya shastra, Nyaya Shastra accepts dharma as that which is generated by performing the duties that is directed by Veda, and it is called Adrishta. Vihita karma janyaha dharmaha tarkasangraha abhyudaya nishreyasa sadhanam dharmaha vaisheshika sutra. The concept of kama is desire. Definition of kama in Kama Sutra is the following. Kama is the enjoyment of the appropriate objects by the five senses of hearing, feeling, seeing, tasting and smelling, assisted by the mind together with the soul. In accordance with dharma is accepted in our darshanas, and it is rightly said in Manusmriti. Akamasya kriya kajit drishyate naiva karhichit yad yad hi kurude jandustattat kamasya cheshtidam. In Mahabharata also we can see the same idea. Nakamah kametyartham nakamo dharmam ruchyati. Then moksha. Moksha means to get rid of or release or liberation. Moksha is also mentioned as a supreme tranquility and the highest bliss. the August assembly know the concept of moksha in our darshana. I am skipping this part also. Now I am coming to the concept of purushartha in Vyakarana Darshana. In Vyakarana Darshana, it is Kayada Svarthika where we see references of dharma for the first time. In the first Vartika, he proclaims that Shabda is Nitya. An articulated sound becomes a meaningful word through its usage among the common world, and grammar only gives the rules to establish the dharma in using that word. In its commentary called Mahabhashya, Patanjali points out that the use of correct words generates dharma and the use of incorrect words generates adharma. P.S. Subramanya Shastri opined that Patanjali in his Mahabhashya mentioned three meanings for the word dharma, namely Nitya Karma, Yajna Karma and Adrishta, in three different instances. Thus, the term dharma used by Patanjali in the above context may be interpreted in these three meanings. This is in accordance, Subramanya Shastri's opinion is in accordance with Nagesha in his commentary of Mahabhashya, namely Udyodha, where he says that some grammarians suggest these three meanings to dharma. Further, Patanjali implicitly mentions moksha while pointing out that language in the language is the great spirit, Devo Rishabha, that has entered into human beings, and the study of grammar helps one to get control of this great spirit, that is to become identified with this essence of mankind. Chatvari Shrungo Trayosya Pada Dve Shirshe Saptahasta Sosya Tridha Vaddho Vrishabhoro Ravidi Maho Devo Martya Avivesha. It is in Bhartrahari's Vakyavadiya that we get the explicit references of the Purusharthas for the first time in a grammatical text. He mentions Vyakarana as the means for dharma and moksha. Concept of Purushartha in Bhartrahari Darshana. In the 4th century AD, Bhartrahari, a great grammarian and philosopher, gave the status of a darshana to the Pandyan grammar by his work Vakyabhariya. The work consists of three khandas called Brahmakanda, Vakyakanda and Padakanda. Of these, the first khanda introduces the concept of Shabda Brahman as the ultimate reality. The world we experience is a vivarta of Shabda Brahman. He describes Vyakarana as a means to the realization of Shabda Brahman, and according to Vyakarana Darshana, this realization is called moksha. Hence, in order to understand the concept of moksha in Vyakarana Darshana and means of attaining it, one should be familiar with the concept of Shabda Brahman. The concept of Shabda Brahman. Vakyabhariya begins with a statement that the whole phenomenon of the external world is only an illusion, vivarta, of Shabda Tattvam, which is identical with the ultimate reality, Brahman, Anadinidaram Brahma. This Brahman is unique and has neither beginning nor end and is unchanging, but on the base of its various powers such as time, which though in essence identical with it, seems to be different in the form of this phenomenal world. Time is an inherent power of the Shabda Brahman and exerts its influence in bringing about its powers. Attaining the absolute knowledge of this Shabda Brahman, which resides in every human being, which is the basic cause for the entire world of things, whose individuality consists only in names and forms, is moksha. Thus, according to Vakyabhariya, to become united with the great spirit, Mahan Rishabha, is called moksha. Those who know Shabda Tattva become united with it. The same idea was seen in Mahabhashya, in the verse quoted before, Chatvari Shrunga Trayosya Pada. It is pointed out in the commentary of Vakyabhariya that Shabda is of two types, one that resides in Prana, the audible sound, and the other that resides in Buddhi, the eternal state of Shabda, that is Shabda Tattva. Shabda, which is beyond prana, gives up its divisions as syllables, words, etc., and also their sequences, and remains indivisible Shabda Tattva, residing in Buddhi. In order to attain this state, we have to acquire dharma by the proper knowledge and usage of Shabda, thereby removing all constraints of avidya, ahankara, etc., which may lead to the identity with the inner light, Shabda Tattva. Vyakarana as a means for attaining dharma and moksha. It is described in Vakyavadiya that Vyakarana is a door to Abhavarga or moksha, and also it is the royal road to those who are desirous of attaining moksha. Usage of correct words with the knowledge of Vyakarana leads to the realization of the true nature of Shabda and the identification of Shabda Brahman. Tad Vyakaranam Adhigamya Param Brahmadi Gamyate. The knowledge of Vyakarana also helps to attain Dharma. It is said in Mahabhashya that Shabda and its meaning are not created by anybody but are known from the world. The role of Vyakarana is to make rules to these words which are already there in the usage of the community. The correct usage of words generates dharma, which is the stepping stone to the moksha. In the Vakyavadiya also, the correct usage of words is accepted as a means to attain dharma and the incorrect usage to adharma. In the commentary, Paddhati of Vrishabhadeva explained that dharma is based on the rules in Shrutis and Smritis regarding anything in day-to-day life, as this can be done or this cannot be done, this can be revealed or this cannot be revealed, and this can be eaten or this cannot be eaten, etc. These rules go from one generation to other by tradition without any break. Hence, it is voluntarily acceptable. Therefore, as we consider violence, theft or dishonesty as forbidden by tradition, likewise the usage of incorrect words are considered as sources of adharma by the same tradition. Hence, Vyakarana Shastra is, as any other smritis, the authoritative works on the rules for acquiring dharma. Further, Bhartahari emphasized that except from agama or tradition based on Shruti and Smriti, one cannot attain dharma, and even logic has nothing to do with it. Logic may not work in some instances where tradition is so much deep-rooted. He also opined that dharma, which has its foundation in Shruti, is a cause for jnana or knowledge. Here in Vyakarana Shastra, the concept of dharma is more close to that of Nayayikas. Vyakarana is the means for sadhu shabda jnana, and its prayoga generates adrishta called dharma, and this leads to abhavarga or moksha. The other two purusharthas, artha and kama, are not discussed in Vakyavadiya, as they can be attained from a life in accordance with dharma. It is natural to use good language to acquire prosperity or desires. Bhartahari was aware about the need for making conscious about dharma by the usage of correct language with its proper knowledge. He advocated dharma, the most important among the first three worldly purusharthas, to attain the fourth one, namely moksha, the realization of Shabda Brahman.
Kindly conclude, madam. Conclusion. Yeah.
In the tradition of Sanskrit education, each knowledge system has its basis in this concept of Purushartha, which is a motivational force for acquiring knowledge with a specific aim. Vyakarana system is not an exception to this. Even though it is a very pragmatic system of knowledge, it has a philosophical background, and the aim of Vyakarana is considered as the realization of Shabda Brahman. Grammarians consider this as the ultimate aim of life, that is moksha. The path to the moksha is through dharma, artha and kama, and among these three, dharma is the most important. Correct use of language is needed for attaining dharma, and this can be practiced through the knowledge of Vyakarana Shastra. Thus, Vyakarana is the first stepping stone in the path of moksha. This is the essence of Purushartha, which is conveyed by Bhartahari in the Vakyavadiya.
Tatra idanim Dr. Siva Mahodaya Prarthyade.
Sarvebhyo Namaha, respected chairman of the session. Our most respected teachers, Professor V.N. Chair, sir, Dr. N.B. Unni, sir, and other learned scholars from different parts of the country. My paper is entitled as Interfacial Perspectives. On Reality in Advaita Metaphysics and Modern Physics. Since the presentation time is cut short to 15 minutes, let me read out some major topics. Thousands of years back, our ancient sages recognized the power of human mind to embrace two kinds of knowledge, the scientific wisdom, rational knowledge, and the spiritual wisdom, the intuitive knowledge. The Mundaka passage, Dev Vidye Vedidavye Paraja Aparajeva, speaks about the twofold division of knowledge, the higher knowledge Para and the lower knowledge Apara. Both science and spirituality are the two approaches adopted by the learned to solve the riddle of the mystery of creation. Hence, they may possess some common currents. Swami Vivekananda explains the interrelation between the scientific wisdom and spiritualistic wisdom as, I quote, "There are two worlds, the microcosms and the macrocosms, the internal and the external. We get truth from both these means of experience. The truth gathered from internal experience is psychology, metaphysics, and religion. From external experience, the scientists accumulated principles of the physical sciences. Now, a perfect truth should be in harmony with the experiences in both these worlds. The microcosm must bear testimony to the macrocosm, and the macrocosm to the microcosm. Physical truth must have its counterpart in the internal world, and the internal world must have its verification outside," unquote. Scientific knowledge that belongs to the realm of intellect followed a series of processes like the statement of the problem, gathering experimental evidences, measuring, comparing, and finally presenting the results. They have to inculcate some spiritualistic elements to arrive at proper conclusions, because then only the co-centralized intellect of the scientist is capable of presenting and clarifying his results. Our mystical sages also applied their intellect to analyze and interpret their intuitive experiences regarding the nature of reality by following certain preparatory stages, and finally provides exact utterances. Spiritualistic experience is the outcome of many years of dedicated effort, along with prerequisites like spiritual instructions from an experienced master, followed by practicing Shama, Dhamma, Uparati, and so on. Scientists also are able to empty all thoughts and feelings of their mind by practicing these disciplines, thereby become eligible to realize the undifferentiated knowledge that is logically accurate. Like spiritual inquiries, scientific studies also requires dedicated training for many years in carrying out serious experiments. They always arrived at accurate resolutions which were experimentally justified. During these discoveries, the scientist himself have experienced such a moment where all the thoughts, feelings of the mind were emptied, and then it is filled with the information regarding his new findings. This mental mode is necessary in effectively furnishing the conclusions of the research. Even though physics arrives at concluding remarks by experimental observations, and metaphysics reaches its primarily mentally, both these disciplines need a spiritualistic element in presenting a rational explanation of the nature of things. Science, through the method of experimentation, and philosophy, through its particular method of meditation, reaches the upshot of their inquiry, but they have to present a detailed interpretation of their findings through meaningful words. This expansion of the abstract of findings in a logically acceptable manner is necessary for their acceptance and further study. Science in the beginning only gave importance to the observable part of the universe. Later, it tries to resolve the riddle of the mystery of man. The rapid developments in the field of science and technology, as well as the emergence of highly sophisticated machinery, enabled our scientists to probe deeper and deeper into the obscurity of nature. Modern findings in the field of science invoke the scientists about the incapability of logical reasoning in presenting the findings of the study. Many such studies led to several thought-provoking modifications in scientific views regarding the building blocks of universe. For instance, the Newtonian model was the basis of classical physics up to the 17th century. Later on, the developments in the field of physics shattered the views of classical physics, since it was applicable only in the motion of solid bodies. The discovery of radioactivity in 1896 and that of radium in 1898 had shattered the indestructibility and indivisibility of atoms. Later, in 1905, Albert Einstein tried to assemble Newtonian mechanics and electrodynamics through his relativity theory. Here, Einstein put forth his famous equation, E is equal to mc squared. According to this equation, mass is nothing but a form of energy. Einstein put forth the general theory of relativity by incorporating gravity. Later, Einstein, in his special theory of relativity, represented a new dimension of looking at electromagnetic radiation. This theory firmly informs that mass is indestructible and is only be transformed from one form into other forms of energy. The most valuable contribution of modern physics is the quantum field theory that ensures the continuous medium present everywhere in space. To quote Project Capra, particles are merely local condensations of this field, concentrations of energy which come and go, thereby losing their individual character and dissolving into the underlying field, unquote. This view goes hand in hand with the Advaita concept of ultimate reality, Brahman, the supreme force behind all the universal phenomena. According to Advaita, the phenomenal world that we perceive is only an appearance. Underneath this ephemeral world, there is an unchanging supreme reality, Brahman. Swami Sohananda explains this, and I quote, "Modern science now accepts the theory that the essence of all matter is energy, a theory that unifies the physical world. Long before the birth of Einstein, the sages of the Upanishads, who realized this through inspiration or intuition, declared this unity," unquote. Swami Vivekananda briefly codifies this idea as, I quote, "All science is bound to come this conclusion, and in the end, manifestation and not creation is the world of science today. And the Hindu is only glad that what has been cherished in his bosom for ages is going to be taught in more forcible language and with further light from the latest conclusions of science," unquote. The intrinsic structure of atomic physics with the support of radioactivity was explored by a team of scientists including Niels Bohr from Denmark, Louis de Broglie from France, Erwin Schrödinger from Austria, Werner Heisenberg from Germany and Paul Dirac from England. These abstract entities, or the subatomic particles, existed both as particles and as waves. The electromagnetic radiation is treated as it always possesses dual nature of particles and waves. Schrödinger, who discovered a quantum theory, is a strong advocate of Vedanta. Walter Murray, his biographer, supplements this. "The unity and the continuity of Vedanta is like the unity and continuity of wave mechanics. Schrödinger and his followers created a universe based on inseparable waves of amplitudes. The postulation of particle physics indicates the dynamic pattern of the constituent particles of a matter where the energy manifests as the particle mass. This shattered the classical view of matter as an object comprises of concrete building blocks. Instead, it put forth the theory that the particles are in constant motion and they collide with one another, thereby emitting energy, resulting in the fragmentation of particles. This process of collision of particles and creation of new particles out of energy involved in the collision process continue absolutely, and these atomic particles can be treated as destructible and indestructible at the same time. Thus, modern physics expresses the completely alterable nature of matter, since all particles can be transformed into smaller particles. The unreality of the world was first discussed scientifically by Heisenberg through his uncertainty principle. According to this principle, we cannot determine precisely both the position and momentum of a particle simultaneously. With the change in velocity, naturally there occurs a change in momentum. Therefore, when we try to determine exact position of a particle, normally its momentum changes. Similarly, when we try to measure the momentum of a particle, naturally its position changes. The building blocks of this universe, whether they be atoms, subatomic particles or subatomic microparticles, we cannot measure accurately both the momentum and position of a particle. These particles have no real existence. They have only tendencies to exist. These advanced revelations of modern science directed Western philosophy, religion, and science to review and rethink their conceptions about ontological dualism. The non-dual philosophy of Acharya Shankara admits Brahman, the supreme reality, as existence, sat, consciousness, chit, and bliss, ananda. Brahman alone is the real thing. All others are illusory. The ultimate reality is the only truth, devoid of any kind of distinctions. This Brahman is the self-manifesting power behind the created things. The maxim Sarvam Khalidam Brahma indubitably perceives the supreme being Brahman as the unifying principle behind the underlying multiplicity. The transformation of Brahman in the world is only an apparent one. Here, Brahman is the reality and the world is only an appearance. The cause of the world appearance is avidya, and by transcending this avidya, one can realize Brahman, the finite ground behind this world. The findings of quantum physics also move in the same direction. They also postulate the unreal nature of objects. They only appear to exist as proton, the electron, etc., and are not real entities. They can be neither the subject nor the object. They appear and disappear. This view is identical to the Advaitin's worldview of neither existent sat or non-existent asat. These theories are still pondering and remain to be provable through experimentation. Consciousness remains as an essential condition in scientific discoveries. This phenomenon is outside the purview of science and remains inaccessible. Only an enlightened person with ultimate control of the senses and ardent wish for immortality should perceive this consciousness. However, the advancements in modern science has shown that there is an inseparable unity, a hidden fabric of laws of nature which governs the natural phenomena with accuracy. Behind every observable external manifestation, there are some inner manipulating and controlling power that affords the desirable outcome, whether it is the observer consciousness or any other reality. Advaita, the most fascinated contribution of India to the world of intelligentsia, champions Brahman, the ultimate reality, as the basis of the entire universe. The Brihadaranyaka passage, Neti Neti, is the only right way of solving this riddle. A satisfactory explanation to this mystery of man and the universe is presented in Brihadaranyaka as, Brahman indeed has two forms, gross and subtle, mortal and immortal, finite and infinite. Here, Brahman connected with the body and senses constitute the basis of all activities is designated as the mortal and finite form of Brahman. The very same Brahman, devoid of all limiting adjuncts, is the immortal, infinite, and non-dual being. Here, man is described as a part of nature which surrounds him. At the same time, he is conscious of this nature through consciousness. Brihadaranyaka further declares the mutual relationship between these two worlds as Purnamadaha, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachyade, Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avashishyate. Let me conclude with the following remarks. Both ancient sages and modern scientists are seeking answers and satisfactory explanations to the questions regarding the origin of universe along with the animate and inanimate existence. Of course, there may be some dissimilarities in the aims and methods of metaphysics and modern physics. However, it is indisputable that the conceptual replica of Advaita metaphysics is amazingly agrees with that of modern physics. Recent developments in quantum physics have sharpened the inadequacy of scientific methods in describing universe and universal phenomena. Physicists have to incorporate consciousness in their scientific inquiries, since it is essential to describe the nature and reality of subatomic particles. Relativity theory and quantum physics forced the scientists to treat the universe as an unbroken whole, including the observer and the observed. Advaita metaphysics provided a more comprehensive view of man and the universe through its ultimate principle, the supreme reality, Brahman. Since Advaita is the only philosophy that ever possessed the capacity to imbibe the modern concepts of every branches of science, it could be taken as a vibrant catalyst to the human thought process. This is not a perfect extensive study on the complementary conceptions of Advaita Vedanta and Advaita metaphysics and modern physics in respect of reality. The attempt made here is to share my view that the fascinating prophecies of Advaita have to reinterpret in the format of physical science for accumulating a scientific horizon. Similarly, scientists have to furnish adequate space to metaphysics while exploring the mystery of universe. Since the theories developed during the last two centuries are equipped enough to endorse the Advaitic narrations of reality. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I invite Dr. K. Muppalmani. Please.
Vanakkam. Vanakkam in Tamil. Namaste, namaskaram, hari om. I am called as Muppalmani. Thank you. Respected chairperson and eminent scholars, I am going to present my paper. Manimegalai in Tamil Nadu. Manimegalai is an epic. Tamil is a language of Tamil Nadu for more than 3000 years. Tamil is a classical language. Manimegalai is a Buddhist epic in Tamil. Sitalai Satanar, the author, 450 to 500 AD, was a grain trader in Madurai, is the author of the epic. Buddhism was followed at that time in and around Thailand, India, Nalanda and Karur, Dakshila and Alexandria. Those Asian countries were connected by trading commodities and routes and ideologies of traders and spiritual gurus. During that period, Jewish philosophy of Philo of Alexandria, Neoplatonism of Plotinus of Rome, and philosophy of Arab Hanifs were known to the Tamil people. Lightly, not efficiently, but they know. Buddhism interacted with transcendental concept of cited philosophies. Their transcendental concept expounded the idea, the view, that the mundane life is a punishment or sin. They considered that the objective material is evil. There are also the view that one has to free oneself from the clutches of mundane life to join with the transcendental one. That may be God, that may be Paramapita, Jehovah. This is the ultimate transcendental concept vehemently preached against atheism in India, Sarvaha and Lokayata, and polytheism and idolatry, vision of human soul. But Sautrandhya Yogacara sect of Buddhism is of the view that mundane life is transient. It performs the view that the objective matter is but an illusion and void, sunyata. One can attain the nirvana or mukti through transcendental meditation. This interaction of Buddhism led Nagarjuna of South India, Asanga and Vasubandhu of Taxila to establish Sautrandhika Yogacara of Buddhism. During that period, Jews, Greco-Romans, Arab Hanifs, Persians and Antioch Syrians were in Tamil Nadu. The people called them the multilingual Yavanas, Yavanar, Tamil word. Multilingual, many people, not one people, not particular people. In Tamil Nadu there is a concept, they are Christians. No, they are multilingual. one can attain their nirvana or mukti through transcendental meditation. The culture followed them was totally rejected by Buddhists. The Yavanas rejects Buddhism at that time. But the datas are not found here in Tamil. We can find there. One professor asked me, Yavanas come and with trade materials, with gold coins and returned with peppers and herbs. But what is their ideology? There is no data in Tamil language. But there are temples in Tamil Nadu. Temple means there must be a guru, there must be ideologies, there must be a philosophy, but they not found in Tamil. But we can find there in Mediterranean area. They have collected all their materials. Through that materials, we find that. About Philo of Alexandria and Plotinus of Greek Roman. At that period, Buddhism was in Southeast Asia. They interacted each other, Nabutsev also. Nowadays, the Buddhism is the main opponent to them in Southeast Asia. Following this process at that days, the epic Manimegalai was written in Tamil. Manimegalai was born as a daughter of courtesan harlot. She despised their family tradition and followed Buddhist custom. She acquired Amudu Surabhi, a vessel, then uninterrupted providing food. With the help of that vessel, he fed blind, deaf, crippled, orphans, disabled, diseased people and wayfarers. She converted the prisons into court of charity. Chautrandiya Yogasara, Buddhism has attained such a kind of earnest philosophical eminence at that time in all over Southeast Asia. The Solomon message of epic Manimegalai is that social harlotry should be uprooted and the prisons must be transformed into court of charity. This is my content of my article. The message of Manimegalai also. The postmodernism nowadays states that women, the suppressed and untouchable and tribal people have to be freed from the clutches of the dominance of the society. The postmodernism as a politics. This downtrodden mass are suppressed by Aryans or Vedantists. So they have a politics here against Buddhism also. The Buddhist epic Manimegalai spread with certainty that the message, those who had been punished by law and tradition customs should be provided with ways and means to turn over a new leaf. This is an interaction of Manimegalai with postmodernism and an epoch-making message from Tamil Nadu, India. Thank you very much. I have...
Any question, please? Professor Varkedi.
Postmodernism is a trend nowadays. The philosophy of postmodernism is positivism. Sometimes neo-positivism also. Now I have no time to deal all these things. I abridged my essay only one page. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mupal Maniji. Acha Mupal Mani. Okay. So the last paper is by Brahmacharini Purbi Chaitanya.
समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं सर्ववेदांत सिद्धांत ग्रतितं निर्मलं शिवं सदाचारं प्रवक्ष्यामि योगिनां ज्ञानसिद्धये. Salutations unto the feet of Paramapujya Gurudev, chairperson here, and all the great scholars who have been assembled here. I request all of you to kindly pay attention, because maybe till now you got used to only listening to paper, and now I would like all the inputs. It is not that I am going to present you something, but I am going to learn from you now. Now, next 15 minutes, I request you all to give me your full attention. This presentation of mine, the topic also is, first they said it is very abstract, I don't know what you are going to talk, but my topic is universally acclaimed aspects in a garb. They have misprinted it, it's on the last sheet of the book, or religious practices, but I wanted to say of religious practices. So there are many practices in all religions available, in and through, they are all having a universality which we need to connect, which is what I thought would be correct for this education. So first, salutations to the gurus, next. Now, before we begin, we have to start. Now, my first question, till now you have been asking questions. Now, my first questions to all of you. When we say Shastra, can please scholars give me the definition? What is Shastra? Kindly. I am a newborn into this world of scholars. So, kindly, help me. Shastra means what? And please keep in view that you are talking to children. You are not talking to scholars. You are talking to a child. What will you say, Shastra? To them, what do you want them to understand? What is Shastra? Anyone here, please? Please. As I said, you are supposed to think and answer now. You can be loud.
There could be many definitions.
Yeah, but
one of the definitions, Samsanat, Sasanat, Chaiva, Shastra, Mitya, Vidhiyate.
Shastra is something that you will?
That rule.
Yeah, rule. Okay. If I say rule,
yes.
Shashanam, if I say, for example, right. Do you think our children will accept it? Now, my second question is, will the child be ready today in nowadays generation? We all have accepted rules. But will today's children accept this? They don't like any rules.
We have to call they it don't a, want a system, rules. A system, a science.
So, yeah. I would like to reframe it, please, with your permission. I would say Shastra as science. Can we take it? Please, rethink. Shastra is science, okay, fine, thank you. Now, let me go ahead. Then, education. What is education then? We have all been giving me these definitions. Now, this word, how did it come or who founded it? And all this, there's a lot of deliberation I've been seeing. But I want a small clipping that to see.
There is one more. Incredible fact. It's already open.
Now I want you to see this carefully. Start. Please read this by yourself. I am not doing the reading. Thank you. And these are all what was taught at that time. So many students studied, and the products of Takshashila, next the Nalanda University, and the Nalanda University had all these great things happening there. The number of students, the number of, you know, the acharyas present there, and each acharya could master 50 sciences. How was this possible then? We are unable to complete one science. Please go back and hold it. Now when this was happening, something else happened. Now I request one of you, please take the mic and kindly read this. One of you, please, one of you. I know you've been listening, so I want some, yeah, please Amma.
The fall of Indian culture and knowledge.
No. Yeah, this one.
Oh my goodness, it's very small.
Anyone else? Yes.
It's time for me to change my specs.
I know. Anyone else who could do that, please?
I have traveled across the length and breadth of India, and I have not seen one person who is a beggar, who is a thief. Such wealth I have seen in this country, such high moral values, people of such caliber that I do not think we would ever conquer this country unless we break the very backbone of this nation, which her spiritual and cultural heritage, and therefore I propose that we replace the old and ancient education system, her culture, for if the Indians think that all that is foreign and English is good and greater than their own, they will lose their self-esteem, their native culture, and they will become what we want them, a truly dominated nation.
When was this said, ma'am?
When was,
Bevington Macaulay.
Macaulay's address to the British Parliament, which was given on 2nd February 1835.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Amma. Please clap for her, please. Now, please understand, this is the cause for why we don't admire, or we think that Vedas are some literary work and not science. This has somehow got into our way of thinking, and we believe it and live it also. But kindly, I want to differ here that Vedas are not literary works. When we say Newton's law, it is a law, as rightly said by sir. You know, Shastra, Shashanat, it says this is a law, that's it. But unfortunately, what we say today is Vedas are scriptures being written by some poets. Please, we have to rethink on this first line, please. This is my first thought-provoking idea to you, sir. Now, the second thing which I want you to think about. There was a colony of slums in Mumbai, and one NGO wanted to reform them initially because, you know, they wanted them to have proper hygienic conditions. They were not in proper hygienic condition. They wanted to teach them. So in the NGO, there was two groups which became. And one group said, no, we will go and teach them what is important, what is correct. We'll go and conduct classes telling them if they don't be hygienic, if they don't wash their hands, they'll get diseases. We'll go and teach them. There was another group in that same NGO who said, no. We will go and make them do what we want them to do. Now they said, we can't come to final conclusion. Then the head of the institution said, why don't we take up this in this way? I don't want to displease both of you. You go and do the teaching in this particular area. Go, teach them. And you make them do it. Don't tell them why it is important, what it is important, but please tell them what to be done. Now, they found that after 1 month, when this 1 week program was over, after 1 month when they went back to see what is the real change that has come, they found this group which went to teach. What happened there? Do you think it has, change has come? What do you think? What is your guess? No change. But this group, who did not tell them why you have to do what you have to do, but the total scenario changed over there. The reason being, it became their habit. And then it was very easy that they were washing their hands, doing everything, because they got habituated to do it.
Kindly, so, excuse me, we have another program after this.
I know. I'll just conclude.
So kindly wind up. Kindly wind up, yes.
I would like to conclude that, please, if you give me 2 minutes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you. I would like to conclude that if we want real change in the education, we have to rethink on the basics, on the fundamentals of it. And the fundamentally thinking is that we have to think that we have to give materialistic education, and this cannot be combined together. But traditionally, it has been going on. Only thing is, like these people, you know, who went and did it. We were always doing traditionally some things. We didn't know the meaning why we were doing it. But there is a scientific reasoning for everything that we do in all our religious practices. In and through all our religious practices, there is a scientific way of looking at things. And that has a lot of impact. First thing, it has an impact on our memory. Because today, if you go to any educational institutions, I have visited nearly hundreds of institutions where they have called me, and the only problem of the children today is memorizing. Why they fail to memorize? What is the memory's limit, please? 1 GB, 2 GB? Anyone here? What is our memory's limit? Any limit? It is unlimited. But still, we are unable to invoke this. And this was what was given in Upanayana Samskara. What is Upanayana Samskara? We all think some Brahmin boys, or it is also a major misunderstanding that only when you want to do Vedic study, Upanayana Samskara has been done. But to differ, in Chinmaya Mission, Swami Chinmayananji and Sharada Priyananji, who is the first devotee, she has done the Upanayana Samskara to all the children, irrespective of caste, creed and religion, and did it even to girls, because you are coming for education. The Upanayana Samskara was done for what? Education, please. So, if you go into the scientific aspect of Upanayana Samskara, what it does, the Gayatri Mantra has the power, that Shabda Brahmeti, that it has the power to activate your memory. Unfortunately, children don't have this. And please, this is a practical thing which I have done, experiment which I have done, which I am sharing with you. And that's why it's not a paper presentation, it's an experience sharing. I have challenged many groups that you please chant this and see if it is really working. And if it is not, please forget it. And many people have come back to me and told me that, yes, Amma, you were right. It is helping me a lot. I am able to retain more. And when the major problem is exams. At the time, I'm unable to reproduce. So this aspect of, you know, education is totally forgotten. We only talk about what, you know, big changes. But what really the child is suffering with is what I came here to advocate. The child is suffering, not knowing how to memorize, how to remember, how to put it back on the paper, because doesn't know. And we think that all these religious practices, in whichever, now I have come to know in this session itself, that every religion has got such a practice where the child is initiated into discipline. So this is what is Shankaracharya Sadachara also says. I would like to conclude with this 12 step. I'll only go do the steps so that you can think over it. I'm not here to explain it. He said, Pratasmaranam, Shaucham, Snanam, Agamarshanam, Sandhya, Japaha, Tarpanam, Agnihotram, Archanam, Maunam, Dhyanam, Bhojanam. This is what happened with Swami Chinmayananji in his life. If we all are standing here today, it is only because of that great master. And we have come to know from his life that it seems in his house, until unless there was no prayer being conducted for 1.5 hours, they would not get the morning breakfast. So this has to be completed, and then alone you would get chance to eat. And if the same these things to be postulated into our own method of life in our day-to-day living, then I'm sure our all children will be really able to reach that universal spirituality. But please, it's my request, don't say Vedas as literature. They are science. This is my only request.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We had very excellent presentations. Starting with Professor P. Ali Palit, who brought to us Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his education system. And on that, Professor Jhaji has actually commented upon that in a very bright way, that he is one of the examples, bright examples of that system which worked in the Gurukulam where he was for a few years. So this Vaishnavism, actually Vaishnavism is a great, you can say, a great tradition, and particularly after Acharya Shankara, whatever comes to us is Bhakti Vedanta, and their Bhakti has a dominance. And coming to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it is Shuddha Bhakti or Raganuga Bhakti, as they call it. So this Bhakti is one of the inseparable parts of our systems. Even in other systems, Bhakti plays a very important role. Then Professor Srinivas Barkhedi, he brought to us Madhvacharya and his Dvaita Vedanta. Dvaita Vedanta, those five distinctions, and particularly that Jayatirtha or Vyasatirtha perhaps, who says, Sriman Madhvamate Harih Paratama, Satyam Jagat Tattvataha, Bheda Jivagana Harir Anuchara, Nichocha Bhavam Gata, Muktir Naija Sukhanu Bhuti Ramala, Bhaktishchatata Sadhanam, Akshadi Tritayam Pramana Makhilam Nayaika Vidyo Hari. So this is in a very short manner, this is the entire philosophy of Madhvacharya. He lays a great emphasis on bhakti, and there are two kinds of bhakti there. One is sadhana bhakti, through which we get liberation. Another is sadhya bhakti, which we practice along with the Lord in that Vishnu loka. So there are one thing I shall tell you, that when different systems are working in Western sciences and philosophy also, they have one criterion of truth called workability criterion. Our systems are working very fine. Okay, there may be differences, but even in spite of the differences, when a system is working, we should just tune it to our contemporary times. If a system is working, as rightly pointed out by Professor Barkhedi, that a learning center he has created, how to give Madhvaite system to the present boys and girls in the schools and colleges? How can they be trained in that system, along with the sciences, along with the social sciences, other things? How can they study? So also here I find that how to give Advaita to the students, of all kinds of students, so that is through experiential learning they can also grow up. Along with culture, they can have modern education. Then the other paper in the other session after tea break, Dr. Srinivasan N. Acharya, Dvaita Concept of Spirituality. He spoke of that inseparability between divergent objects, these five kinds of Veda. Because that five kinds of Veda, they are ultimate Vedavadins, they are realists. And the Advaitins, they are idealists. Only Advaitins are not idealists, but the Sunyavadins are also idealists. The Vijnanavadins are also idealists, the Shabdadvaitavadins are also idealists, and in some of the Kashmira Advaita Saivagamins, they are also idealists. But they claim that they are realists along with being idealists. So this realism and idealism, this dualism and non-dualism, this goes through all the Indian and Western, their philosophical systems, either were dualists or were non-dualists. But these are frameworks. When we have frameworks, we have also one kind of achara parampara, one kind of systemic. When the systemic works, then actually it continues. So hundreds of years, one system, each system has taken hundreds of years, and each system works very fine. And exclusively we cannot say that this system is correct and that system is not. So this kind of mutual tolerance, not mutual tolerance, but mutual cooperation. that we find goodness in other systems also. How much even our own Nyaya system, how much it has learned from the Buddhists, and how much the Buddhists in earlier phase, they have learned from the Nyaya system and other systems. How much people have taken from the Vedas and the Upanishads? If we think of that, then we can coexist. So that there will not be one format. One can't have that kind of thinking that everybody thinks alike. Everybody falls into the same position. No, that we should not accept. So then Dr. Mrs. Yamuna, she spoke of the Purusharthas and particularly the concept of moksha in Bhartiyari's philosophy. I asked her to connect it to the main theme of the seminar, and they have also Bhag Yoga and so many other things, and in a way language that paves our way to all kinds of knowledge. So that knowledge, that language, how to bring about a science of language that Panini and Patanjali and other grammarians, they attempted in their own way, and they also consider moksha as one of the objectives of life. So Bhartiyari comes to moksha in his Vakyapadiyam. Dr. A. Shiva, she had a very fine paper on reality in modern physics and also Advaita Vedanta metaphysics. To me, what I think, see, physics, say theoretical physics, is it physics proper? It is physics plus metaphysics. If you read through Einstein, some of his idealistic writings, if you read the Stephen Hawking, some of the writings of Newton, then you find physics and metaphysics together, that they call theoretical physics. So when you theorize, then you have to be a philosopher. I think a critical, fundamental philosopher, scientist, he has to be 50% philosopher and 50% scientist. So philosophy, as said by Francis Bacon, that also included science, history, science and poesy, only three domains of knowledge, he said, and philosophy contained science. So this is something good, and see, philosophy and science, the comparison she made out, and a kind of overview of the scientific development in physics, she made it very clear. So it is a good paper. Dr. K. Muppalamani brought to us a forgotten page of Buddhism, that too in Tamil Nadu. And he spoke of Nalanda, Takshila, and Buddhism in Alexandria also. And 450 to 500 AD, so what is the position of Buddhism in Tamil Nadu? Perhaps now this thing we have forgotten in history, but also there was a Buddhist chapter to Tamil's history. Then the last presentation by Brahmacharini Purbi Chaitanya, this was something good. The thing is known how in the British Parliament, Babington Macaulay, he gave a speech, and on the basis of that, our maybe Indian culture, our Sanskrit language, our Shastras, how the tools and paathshalas, they were locked in Bengal and other parts of the country, all these things. During colonial rule, Sanskrit, what kind of rules it faced. Sanskrit was in a way almost closed. So, but still, how people saved Sanskrit, how that Sanskrit culture was brought up. And the Vedas till now, till date, the Western scholars, the best among them, they are not ready to accept Rig Veda even before 1500 BC. That is the best of the Western scholars. They don't accept the Vedas to go beyond 1500 BC. And the Mahabharata war before 950 BC, they don't take it back. So for us, it is 3000 years before Christ, Mahabharata war, 3200-02 or something. And the Vedas, they go back. So that way the Vedas are science, but what kind of science they are, how to bring out the scientific elements from the Vedas, that needs something. Only faith doesn't matter. And these sciences as they are highly realistic, and they are also workable. Our religion also is workable. So there is one religious model, there is a scientific model, there are also spiritual models. So how to bring about a kind of synergy, a kind of mutual cooperation among different branches of knowledge, and how to give all these things to the new generation of the young people, they are coming up, their problems were being discussed by Professor Varkheri, how there is a generation gap. So how to minimize the generation gap? There was a generation gap. Professor Jhaji, he knows how to Pakshadhara Mishra, Raghunath Shiromani comes, and he is of a different opinion. He goes back, has his own school of logic in Bengal, Bengal school of Nabya Nyaya. So you have to differ. Differing is not a bad quality. Among religions, among sciences, even some people combat the Vedas, let them find out something new. But we have to have some room for the other. Unless we have the place for the other religion, the other science, the other philosophical system, the other kind of spirituality, and sometimes we have got to be aware about the new age spiritual teachers and preachers. A lot of them are there. You find in the airports, in the bus stands, in the railway stations, so many books, monographs, they are coming up. New age spiritual literature. So reading through them, you find as if you are going through a paraphrase of some of the Upanishadic lines, some of the Vedic passages, some of the Buddhist and Jaina literature passages, like that. But they are highly meaningful. They guide people. Sometimes they come to India, they have some classes like this, and they offer their new rules of spirituality, and they also charge a fee on our people and their people. So the new age spiritualism, we have to think our age-old spiritualism in the Vedas, in the Upanishads, in our Shastras, that kind of spirituality, what that makes us rich to. And this kind of spirituality that they practice, particularly after Jain Buddhism, I think, that this kind of spirituality and the practices they came to our society. So what is the difference? Suppose a man in the Madhvai tradition, in the Sankara tradition, in some other religious tradition, in the Sikh tradition, and the kind of spirit they evolve for the society, for the universe, and the kind of spirit that one develops through coming through the new age spiritualist literature and practices. Let us make a comparison, and if possible, we can go back to some of the good ideas that we had in the past, and also we can accept some of the things that the new age spiritualist leader speaks to us. So we have to make a comparison for that, experiment and experiential learning. Unless we do something, it doesn't matter. As that madam was telling, Gayatri mantra is there, fine. But we don't make a practice of it. Any mantra is there, any vidhana is there, any karmakanda is there. If we don't make a practice of this, then it won't work. So perhaps this multiplicity of religions, this multiplicity of sciences, this multiplicity of philosophical systems, they are there, they have to be there. Why? I should quote Pushpadanta in his Mahimna Stotra, Trayi Sankhyam Yoga Pashupati Matam Vaishnavamiti Prabhinne Prasthane Paramidamadah Pathyamitija Ruchinang Vaichitriyat Rujukutila Nana Pathajusam Nina Meko Gamya Stamashi Payasa Varnavaiva. But that Eko Gamya, whether that is one or that is many, we have to decide. So with these words, I thank this great institution created at the birthplace of one of the greatest thinkers, Adi Shankara Nilayam, Swami Advayananda, the president, and Dr. Dilip K. Rana, the director of this Shodha Samsthanam for having invited me here, that this galaxy of scholars I see before me. I had occasion to listen to them, and I am also, I did this task, but I am not equal to this task. And because to preside over such variegated subjects, very difficult. One cannot be an all-knower. Sarva sarvam na janati sarvajyo nopapadyate na ikatra parinishthasti janasya puruse kvachit. Let us belong to one sampradaya, practice certain things, and also have some knowledge of the other sampradayas. Sometimes be critical of them, but also be cooperative to them, understand them, be compassionate to them, that everyone has a place under the sun on this earth. Thank you very much.